Hi folks, I would like to introduce myself. My name is Payal and I am a traveler who also loves to meet people. And I think a blend of both is where this concept of melting pot has come about. In my melting pot series, I will be talking to lots of inspiring people from different parts of the world and also from different cultures, whom I meet during all my travels. The common factor between these folks will be the desire to follow their passion and make it a way of life. So step into this melting pot and enjoy the chats. Hi everyone, welcome to another episode of Melting Pot with me, Payal, and this time I am in Barcelona and I am talking to this very, very inspiring lady. Her name is Julia, and Julia has a lot of interesting things to tell us about, so I'm not going to waste any more time. And I am just going to very quickly say hello to Julia.
Hello, Payal.
Yeah, and so Julia has been in Barcelona for several years, but she's originally from Austria. And then now she's got this wonderful brand called Le Pure. So this is like a really quick introduction, but, you know, because I really, really want Julia to tell us all about it. So thank you for talking to me. And, you know, and we're just, my listeners and I are waiting to hear everything that you have to tell us. So it's basically your journey.
Thank you very much, Payal, for this invitation to share my story. So yes, my name is Julia Atzesberger. I was born in Vienna, and it's now been 19 years that I came to Barcelona. In the beginning, it was in the search for sunshine. You know, Vienna is a wonderful city, but sometimes a bit gray in the winter. So I came and I fell in love with this city, with, you know, being next to the sea.
So did you come here to work? Or
I was supposed to go to Madrid to transfer with my company then, where I worked. And that was cancelled in the last minute. And then I had everything sorted out, left my apartment, my car, and the suitcases were packed. And then I said, okay, you know. And I had a friend in Barcelona. And so I went to, I just took the suitcase and say, okay, let's see. I go to Barcelona instead of Madrid.
Right.
And I came here, and then, you know, I started to learn Spanish. I found one job. First I was teaching German, then English. And then I worked in internet companies for a long time.
Okay.
And, you know, I had a wonderful time here. And so I said, okay, where else would I go after after Barcelona, you know?
I totally agree with you.
And then about 10 years ago, I had a little bit of a skin problem with acne.
Okay.
And I was searching for a solution and, you know, tried different products, also some organic stuff. And
so then, do you think it was diet related, or?
I think it might have been a mixture between hormones and probably stress as well.
Okay.
And also it could be diet related as well. Okay. Since then I've changed my nutrition a lot.
Yeah, that's why I was asking, because you did mention that, you know, earlier that you have changed your nutrition. So
exactly. So this was all like a process, because I met this woman, Marie Carrasquedo, and she's an osteopath. She does naturopathy, aromatherapy, and also her own cosmetic formulations.
Okay.
So I met her and I was really amazed, you know, learning from her, and she also did some courses. So I was getting more and more interested in what she was doing, and more passionate. And we became friends. And then eventually, after 2 years, I said, oh, I mean, you've created so much know-how. why don't we put this on a more international platform? Why don't, you know, we put a nice brand to it and we share all this know-how.
Right.
We share your formulations that she did specifically for the Pure.
Right.
And we share all this know-how that you have around skincare and health. Because
right.
usually
right.
when we have a skin alteration,
yeah.
it is never only something to treat from the outside. There is always an inner reason.
Yeah.
And having a more integrative approach to this,
yeah.
I think is very important.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
And someone who has really spent 45 years dedicating their life and their research and all their passion towards this area of health and skin,
yeah.
I think this is gold. This
yeah.
is not what
yeah.
we
yeah.
have anymore because
yeah.
There's less and less independent researchers
yeah.
around. So it's really something that should be shared. And when you see her and she's 65 and she looks like she's 35,
wow,
has the most amazing skin, then you really see that she's living her philosophy.
Hmm.
It's not something, you know, that's on paper, it's a nice marketing.
Yeah, yeah.
It's really what she believes
so
in.
She was not really, so what was she, you know, when she was formulating different products, she was only like, was it getting marketed or not at all?
It was getting marketed, but on a smaller scale
okay.
than it is now. So
okay.
with the Pure, we're now in 14. We work with stores in 14 countries.
Right. So then you, just backtracking
yeah.
a bit. So then you decided to join hands with her. And
yeah.
what aspect of Le Pure were you keen to, you know, were you keen to promote it as a brand or take it out into the international market? Is that what you were trying to do?
Yes.
Okay.
So together we created these formulas of Le Pure.
Okay.
And,
okay.
And we adapted it also, let's say, to the needs of the of today's needs. So, for example, now we have some travel sizes that are small. There's certain routines that really help when you're in cities and we have to deal with a lot of pollution.
Right. Right.
In terms of scents, the smells of the formulations. We also try to. We have some formulations that are a bit simpler with less ingredients because
yeah.
due to the bad nutrition that we have now, because the food a lot of times we get is not that healthy.
Yeah.
So we're dealing with more permeable intestines. And if you have a permeable intestine,
yeah.
You will have permeable skin. And that
right.
will lead to, we see so many cases of acne, of rosacea, of couperose. And this is all, you know, this is all comes from
your lifestyle,
yeah,
basically.
Your lifestyle
yeah.
and also cosmetic products. Nowadays, we have a lot of products on the market that
yeah.
use chemically modified substances.
Right, right.
So even if they're certified organic, it means if you take like an organic olive oil,
yeah.
but you inject hydrogen into it, so you saturate this oil,
right.
you change the chemical structure of this
right.
ingredient.
Right.
This is still certified organic, it's
mm-hmm.
still of natural origin, but it has very little to do with what you have when you have a cold pressed,
mm-hmm.
first pressing vegetable oil.
Right, right.
So it's very different. One substance the skin can recognize and the other substance is a subproduct of the
mm.
original raw material
mm.
and it can't be recognized anymore.
Right, right.
So we're dealing with a lot of chemically modified substances.
Yeah, yeah.
And
so obviously your Le Pure is completely the opposite of that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Physical production processes. We
yeah.
cold press, we do macerations. Everything that preserves the maximum of nutrients
right.
from the raw material.
Right, right.
Like obviously,
right.
we part from the very highest quality of raw material.
Yeah.
But then when we elaborate and we process, we do the minimal processing
right.
to keep the nutrients.
Right. Yeah.
So obviously, this is a very challenging way to produce. It's
yeah.
a very expensive way to produce.
Yeah.
You have to be, you know, very well what you're doing so that this product then also has a good shelf life
yeah.
and stays stable. So
yeah.
this is a big part that also Marie has done so much research on.
Right, right.
But this helps us, this enables us to eliminate all these substances that the skin can't recognize and that
yeah.
we find in so many skincare products. Organic organic or not organic.
Yeah, yeah.
But the skin is like the rest of the organism. The skin has to eat. It has to absorb.
Breathe.
The ingredients. And if it can't recognize this, it just stays on the surface and gives you a nice illusion of nutrition.
Yeah.
But it's not getting absorbed into the deeper layers and regenerating from within.
Mm, interesting. So now you mentioned earlier that Le Pure has gone into 14 countries now.
Yeah.
You are also, so they get retailed at different stores.
Yeah, they get retailed.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And are you also selling online?
Yes, we're also selling online.
Okay.
And we ship right now, I think last year we shipped to 23 different countries.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's a very high quality niche product.
Yeah.
So we get people from all over the world that hear it or they research and they find it and who really know what the high quality or what we call high performance organic skincare, because it really gives you all the benefits and all the, you know, results you expect from a good skincare, but it still is organic.
Right.
So it long term, it has a positive effect on your body and not the other way around.
Yeah. So what are the different products that you have?
It's basically facial products that we have.
Okay.
So we have a range of creams, of emulsions.
Okay.
We have also a makeup cream, which is also an anti-aging, high nutrition cream.
Right.
But it also has pigments, color pigments inside.
Okay.
And also some sunscreen, physical sunscreen material, titanium dioxide.
Okay.
So it's a very good way when on these days where you don't have a lot of sun exposure to protect and also your skin and to give it a nice glow. It's a very natural way of doing it and healthy way of doing it.
Yeah, of course. I mean, I think that's the most important thing, right?
Exactly.
And so which is your most popular, like do you have a product which is in high demand?
Yes, I mean, we're very particular with our emulsions. When you look at a typical emulsion, it means like you combine oil and water.
Yeah.
And traditionally, like when we started out about 100 years ago, so then Nivea was the first cream, like the first cold cream.
Right.
And so they combined like this petroleum-based oils with water and you have this really like very thick cream. They called it a cold cream.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
So this was kind of what people were starting with. And before that, people were doing maybe some emulsions based with beeswax or other waxes, you know, that were also kind of a bit sticky.
Yeah.
And then after this Nivea, then I think at a certain point in the last century, there came the hydrogenated oils were invented. So in nutrition, we know them from, it's the margarines, the vegetable margarines that they sold us that they're a lot healthier than the animal-based fats.
Right, right.
But then they realized, they found out recently that these fats, because they're chemically modified, that they were clocking the arteries, that people were dying, like, you know, that an excess of this, it was clocking the arteries and causing heart failures.
Yeah,
That's what they found out starting in the 70s.
Mm.
So now, they said, now the vegetable margarine for food is not good for the body. But nobody knows that this same ingredient is a main ingredient in cosmetics. And since they're called with different names, and nowadays most of the people don't know what, because we're not chemists or biologists, we don't know how to read the labels.
Right.
We don't identify that these fats that we is demonstrated is bad to eat is now in most of our skincare. So you can find them in they're called cetearyl alcohol, or caprylic triglyceride, or stearates. Basically, what the advice I give when you read a label, if it's a plant and it keeps the Latin name, every plant has a Latin name, original Latin name.
Yeah.
If you find that this Latin name is used on the label, it usually means that this ingredient has gone only through a physical production process. Yeah, it's
right.
been cold pressed and macerated and so on. Because it's still kind of that plant.
Right. Right.
When this plant goes through a chemical process, it gets a new chemical name. So if you see the Latin name, physical process. If you see the chemical name, you have a chemical process then behind. And then you don't know if your skin recognizes this ingredient, if it's still good for you.
So does it actually, so it penetrates your skin and goes into your...
The chemical modified. Usually not, because the skin won't absorb it. The skin says,
so then it actually has no benefit, right?
Quite the contrary.
Yeah.
It stays on top of your skin and inhibits the skin breathing.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
the skin is the third kidney and constantly it has to expulse toxins and to breathe.
Yeah.
So if you have this plastic, it's like a plastic layer on top, the skin can't breathe, it doesn't get nourished and it can't breathe. It gives us the illusion, this layer, that the skin is nourished. But it's not nourished. We just put like a layer of plastic on. We're happy. We go to sleep. But the skin behind is like suffocating and is not eating. So and these fats, the other problem they have when you have it in formulation, they're very thick. They're very solid. So if you want to create a creamy emulsion from this, you have to add loads of water. So most of the creams nowadays, they will have 60 to 70% of water, then this chemically modified fats, and then what remains as an active ingredient will be sometimes only 10 to 20%.
And you're paying so much money for it.
And some creams they sell for 300 euros, and what you're paying for is chemically modified fat, which is pretty cheap.
And lots of
and
water.
70% of water.
Yeah.
And a very nice marketing.
Yeah. And packaging and all of that.
And
you
also have to consider if it's a cream, if it's an open cream, any cream that contains water, emulsion.
Yeah.
If you can open it, if it's in a jar, and you can put your finger into it, even if it comes with a spatula or whatever, if you can put your finger in it, it is full of preservatives. Because if not, this would go bad within like a few days.
Right.
So even now they talk about the parabens and so on.
Yeah.
Even if it doesn't, if you can't find the paraben on the label, it might now, the new paraben is now called phenoxyethanol or methylisocyanone, or they hide it in the perfume, or they wash the machines in the lab with what they fill it with. So if you can put your finger in, this is a safe product, it's full of preservatives.
You're listening to a fusion of stories recounted for the first time ever by some fascinating people from across the globe with me, Payal, on this very unique and special podcast series, Melting Pot.
And a story I heard recently that from medicine students, you know, when they get, you know, dead bodies to work on. What happens now is the faces do not decompose anymore.
Really?
Because of all the preservatives that we've been putting on for decades in our faces. The faces stay intact.
Oh my God.
Yeah. So we really have to be a bit more, let's say, ask ourselves, what are we putting on our face?
Yeah.
We should only put things on our face that we could actually eat.
Yeah.
So that's what we do. We take the plant, we put the physical process. This is something you could eat.
Yeah.
So all of the ingredients that we do, we use are edible ingredients. And if you cannot, then you really have to question yourself. Right. So, for example, lots of products they use now, they peel the skin a lot.
Yeah.
But you don't want to peel, because the skin has its own microbiota, its skin flora.
Right.
That is a mixture of bacteria that and this hydrolipidic film.
Right.
That is kind of its perfect barrier to keep all the bad stuff out. If you peel or you're very aggressive with this protective film, your skin becomes unprotected. So it's a risk, and it also works against all the anti-aging efforts that you do. There is a lot of things.
It's a whole science behind it.
It's a whole science behind it, and there is a lot of information that you as a consumer do not get.
Yeah.
Because we have to see nowadays, how it has been grown. Now the media industry with everything digital culture is more and more under pressure and is more and more relying on advertisers. So if you have media, you know that there are advertisers behind that media, and that means also you will read or hear the messages of these advertisers in this media. So we have to be more conscious about that. It's unfortunate. I mean, it's not
but
something.
Do you think it's gradually changing? Are people becoming? I mean, I guess with Le Pure, it's still a very niche market.
Yeah.
But do you feel that, you know, the kind of reviews you're getting or the kind of people that are getting in touch with you from all these different countries, is there like an awareness building on how important it is to have like natural products?
Definitely. We're really now in a very, very strong organic oriented market.
Okay.
So, but now nowadays everything is organic.
Yeah.
The problem what we have in cosmetics is there is no state regulation. There's no EU regulation that says this can be called organic or this has to be like this. There is only private certificates at the moment, mainly private certificates.
Okay. Yeah.
These private certificates are made or issued by companies who are profit oriented. Mm. So if it's a profit oriented company, the more substances you certify or allow in your certifications and the more brands and products you certify, the more money you make.
Right.
So the certificates we have nowadays, I mean, it is an indication. Say it's bad because we need some kind of indication, but for us they're light years away from the standard that we are applying to our own product. So obviously an organic cream you can buy for €5 in the supermarket cannot be organic.
Yeah,
you know, it's like with €5 you pay the shelf space, nothing else. The product there,
so
you
the
have
ingredients are obviously substandard.
Obviously you're paying for water, chemically modified fats, and maybe there's a plant that's lost on the way there a little bit. But it's a matter of qualities. For example, in essential oils.
Yeah.
So if you really have, for example, rose essential oil, if you buy it organic, 1 liter will cost €10,000. Obviously, you can have a version that has been produced in a cheaper way, not in this very laborious, slow way with the high quality, and you can buy this for €100 a liter. Mm. Obviously, There's a huge difference between the two. So these are also things we have to have in mind. So what I tell people is ask the producer, ask questions.
Right.
If they have good answers, if they go out of their way to explain how they use and why they use and etc., then I think you can build some trust and see what the difference is.
Yeah.
More and more people that are going for organic, they search for the products. They know there are small companies out there still doing like this, the right thing, or this really pioneer work that Marie has been doing, I mean, since the 70s almost. I mean, it's really something that she's been passionate about all her life.
So that's interesting. I mean, you know, you now, for example, even I do turn, you know, the product and I do look at the ingredients. And based on that, I make my decision on whether I want to buy it or not. So I guess it's a very slow process of people becoming aware.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I just hope by the turn of the century, it's a given, you know, that people move away from synthetic and move more towards, you know, natural. I mean, it's great what you're doing and all the hard work that you're putting in to just make sure that, you know, your message is out there. So you've had a complete lifestyle change, right? In terms of what goes into your body in terms of food, you know, the products that you use externally. So how do you feel after, like physically and emotionally, how do you feel after you've actually had this whole new kind of way of living?
I think for me, and probably also for many people, or for people who want to do a change, I think it's baby steps.
Right.
Doing
so
things
how many years
gradually.
Has it taken you to actually get to where you are today?
I think I've been, I've met Marie 10 years ago and we've been friends for 10 years. So, we shared sometimes, so we were traveling together or we would share, we would make dinner together. So I I'm still learning from her. So it's like, okay, why do you do this? And why do you eat that?
And are you incorporating it into your life?
Yes, yeah. Yes, okay. Definitely. I think this is something that I'm like, okay, it's like, if this is the good way, then this is what you should do. Hmm. Let's say I come from a culture like, which is like a lot of cultures, which is full of wheat products, milk products, and meat.
Yeah.
Yeah. So whenever I go back to Vienna, it's almost impossible to escape those.
Hmm.
And for me, those products, the meat, I don't like so much. I've never liked that much meat. So that was not that difficult. I still eat it sometimes when I know where it comes from.
Yeah.
Yeah. I wouldn't eat it in any restaurant.
Yeah.
And the other two, like milk products, also for an animal cruelty reason, I try to avoid it. Because it's very, very hard to not inflict animal suffering when it comes from, milking a cow. And then the wheat is a very manipulated grain that is also, like, I found out then with going to doctors and so on that it was not very good for my health.
Right.
So eliminating these products or reducing it to a minimum. So I sometimes, if there's an organic cheese, maybe once or twice a month I will eat a little bit of it.
Yeah.
But it's not something that I consciously buy and have it at home.
Yeah.
Sometimes in a restaurant I would eat a little bit. And I eat a lot of gluten-free bread.
Yeah.
Like the buckwheat bread.
Buckwheat bread.
Buckwheat bread.
Yeah.
And I've seen that, my health has changed. Before, I was always on a diet.
Mm.
Always. I could never keep my weight. And now it's almost the opposite. Now sometimes I forget eating. I'm not hungry at all.
Mm.
I don't need sweets at all.
Mm.
I've also done some changes. For example, I was diagnosed to have candida bacteria overgrowth in my intestine.
Okay.
And so I had to do a very strict diet for 3 months.
Okay.
And so that completely now, I don't almost eat any sugar. It's just you get new habits.
Yeah.
And you don't need the other stuff anymore.
Yeah.
And if I want them, if I want to have a big ice cream, I eat the big ice cream. I don't need it anymore.
Yeah.
And the day that I want
so
it,
you don't crave for
I
it.
I will have
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I've even read statistics. And I believe in some countries it's the same, that up to 60% of the people, they have this candida overgrowth in their intestines. In my case, it was pretty sure it was fueled because I had asthma when I was very little, when I was two.
Mm.
And for a year, I got antibiotics every month.
Mm.
So my intestinal flora has always been since then very, very fragile.
Sensitive.
And
yeah.
shaky.
Yeah. Yeah.
So this is something I've been dragging on with me. And when you're young, you kind of overcome that.
Yeah.
But then after 30, you can start to have serious problems. And then if you don't change your lifestyle, if you don't change your nutrition or what you do, then you can start to have health complications in all different ways.
Right.
So it was not a change from one day to the other. Now I have to change everything. I tried always to eat healthy. But for example, I wasn't eating enough good protein, or I wasn't eating enough good fats because I thought fats were bad.
Yeah.
So,
but you have to balance, right? I think that's the key, to be able to figure out. And every person is different. The whole system is different.
Yeah.
So then you, need to experiment and then figure out what works for you and what doesn't.
Exactly.
So
And nutrition is a big priority in my life. It's a priority financially. I try not to save money on high quality foods.
Yeah.
For example, when I was building the company, I built the company from my apartment with like a little bit of money I had saved. I was on zero spending at all. But I wouldn't go to the restaurant, or if friends were going out, then I would go after the dinner for a drink.
Right.
But I would still buy more organic food
to
have and cook it at home.
Yeah.
So that was a priority when I had very little money.
Yeah.
And it's a priority still.
Yeah. Because then it's now become a way of life for you, right?
Exactly. Yeah. I need the good food. And if I eat bad food, then my body complains.
Yeah.
So it's like having a Ferrari and putting cheap fuel into the tank.
Yeah.
It
yeah.
absolutely makes no sense.
Yeah.
And health is the prime good that we have.
Yeah.
And if we want to spend our time happy, feeling good, in prime health, then we need the good fuel.
Yeah. Totally. Yeah. So, I agree. Yeah.
It's been this gradual change, and I think people also they should not be afraid. Just implement one step after the other and everything will come naturally. It's like doing everything like from one day to the other, it also doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
Do it step by step. Start to be more interested in what the food is. And I also try to buy a lot direct from the farmers because we have so many intermediaries now.
Yeah.
And they take away so much margins. So the farmers, they're really like struggling to survive.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then we have these big intermediaries, and nowadays we have lots of platforms where you can connect, where the farmers bring their food or their vegetables or what they cultivate directly to the city at the central point, and you can get it from there.
Yeah.
And this way, farming stays attractive. You can have passionate people who go into this. And we give the money to the people who add value to the planet.
Yeah.
And a lot of times this is not intermediaries because they pressure, you know, they want lower quality, more money, and they try to squeeze and squeeze and squeeze. You cannot squeeze the planet infinitely.
Yeah.
You
can already see what is happening because, you know, the planet is seriously being abused. I think if everyone in some way contributes, like what you're doing, you know, and if multiple people like you do the same thing, then it will make a difference at some point. I mean, so you in your small, very small way, you're sort of helping the farmers, and you're also, you know, through what you have learned and through Le Pure, you're trying to educate people with your products, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's fantastic, and I'm really, really happy, you know, to be talking to someone who's actually so passionate, and I'm sure it's going to be a great ride for you. I'm really happy that we were able to talk about this, and as you know, my podcast series is Melting Pot, where I am talking to really passionate people like yourself who've kind of, you know, changed their lives and just because they have this passion for something, you know, and you are also trying to influence others. So really, really happy to have talked to you. Thank you, Julia.
Thank you very much for inviting me, Paya.
Julia came to Barcelona looking for sunshine, as she says, and has stayed for over 19 years now. Believe me, Barcelona does have this impact on people. I find Julia to be so, so soft-spoken, with a lot of clarity in the way she talks. It's been so inspiring to hear how over time, Julia has made a complete lifestyle change, and her passion to bring Le Pure to the world by creating awareness on how natural is the way forward. It's absolutely super evident. It was such a pleasure chatting with Julia, and hope you, my listeners, enjoyed the conversation as well. So until the next episode of Melting Pot, from yet another part of the world,